Penguin Random House presents Superstar India, From Incredible to Unstoppable by Shobhaa, read by Monaz Ranina. For both my mothers, I and India, and for the 1 billion plus super Indians who have made India a global superstar. Acknowledgements. It started with a phone call. David Davidar was at the Penguin India office in New Delhi and had called for a casual chat. He asked whether I was planning a new book, and I glibly replied, "I am always planning a new book." David went into his mode before asking, "What's it about?" I had to think fast, really, really fast. I tossed two ideas at him. One for a novel, the other for this book. An India book. I must have sounded pretty impassioned as I took off on how I feel about the country and my own life. Seen through that filter, given the fact that India and I are the same age. "You've got your book," David declared crisply, before handing over the phone to Thomas Abraham. "Congratulations," said Thomas, and we were in business. I turn into a monster when a book is on. Several people are compelled to tolerate me while I growl and snap my way through the writing of it. My special thanks to darling Preeta Maitra. A kinder, gentler editor would be hard to find. I feel blessed. Himali Sodhi has seen me through several books and as many adventures while promoting them. It is her quick wit and terrific sense of humor that have prevented many a potential gaffe. Thank you, dearest. Ravi Singh, with his spot-on editorial instincts, provided just the right perspectives each time I was stuck and panic-stricken. My long-suffering husband, Dilip, and the children deserve an equally sincere acknowledgement for their silent support and wicked jokes at my expense, of course. And a big kiss to John Mackinson for keeping the faith and making me feel like a really special member of the extended Penguin family worldwide. And above all, Dhanyavad, India, my joy, my inspiration. Without you, this book would not have been possible to write. Mumbai, December 2007. Prologue. Because I believe. Bhumibol Adulyadej, Thailand's beloved king, turned 80 in December 2007. Millions of his loyal subjects wore yellow on that day. Why? Yellow happens to be the ruler's favorite color, and his people wanted to express their love and respect for the world's longest reigning monarch by being color coordinated with him on his special day. It was an entirely spontaneous, untutored gesture. No manipulation involved. Nobody was paid to conform to the yellow dress code. What a sweet and simple way of demonstrating solidarity and commitment. I thought to myself, as I scanned the papers the next morning, would such a thing happen in today's India? Is there even a single individual with the capacity to touch our hearts, inspire us? Lead us? Alas, the answer is a flat and disheartening no. What then has given India its special glow, its special status? I asked myself that question at least 100 times while writing this book. I believe I finally have my answer. To be a superpower, you need super people. India's biggest strength lies there. We are a super people. The answer surprised me. It was that obvious. And yet, it may just be India's best kept secret. The world is suddenly looking at us with wonderment, even a tinge of envy. India counts. India rocks. India is hot. Why now? What has changed? I believe it is because we have taken the world by surprise. Why? We have taken even ourselves by surprise. We see our freshly minted image and wonder, is that really us? There is charming disbelief in that reaction. But there is also renewed confidence. We have finally started believing in us. Reason enough to rejoice. And with this self-belief, we have started renegotiating our past equation with the world. We are in the happy position to do so, that too, on our own terms. And because of this newfound assertiveness, we are finally ready to invest in ourselves. We know India is offering the best returns. Why look outside? As we once did, when the dazzling story of success and prosperity is unfolding right here, right now. I have a small confession to make. When I began the book, I had a Bollywood song buzzing inside my head. Where's the party tonight? The compellingly catchy track from a widely discussed movie perfectly captured my upbeat feeling towards India, and therefore the book. In fact, I was sorely tempted to make it the theme song for the project, and almost did. But as I continued writing, the heady euphoria of the first few weeks got replaced by a more sober emotion. For us to leverage and sustain the India moment that is dominating our psyche at present, we also need a few reality checks to keep us on course. Even as I took a long, hard look at some of the obvious downsides, what are the three things keeping India down? The answer: corruption, corruption, corruption. I still felt the upsides. What's so fantastic about the India story? The answer: people, people, people. Tilted the scales in our favor. God, if only we knew how to better utilize our greatest national asset, the billion plus people who make us what we are. Either we see them in this positive light and maximize the benefits of those daunting numbers, or we foolishly look at our population as a liability and throw away a natural advantage. Statistics can be as terrifying or reassuring as we'd like them to be. They're mere numbers, after all. It is a fact that 77% of India live on less than 20 rupees a day. Let's not sweep these grim digits under the carpet. But let us also pay attention to another equally relevant statistic. 50% of India is under 35 years of age. That makes us a remarkably young country, with a youth force of 500 million. It is entirely up to us how we harness those energies. Motivate this gigantic mass and get going. Never before has Mera Bharat Mahan been seen as Mera Bharat Jawan. It is indeed a fantastically dynamic growth period in India's 60-year-old life, and we should make the most of our resource. The 20 and 30-somethings who are driving the economic spurt. The future is here, and it is appealingly youthful. These are the new kids on the block. India's hopes, dreams, and aspirations rest with them. Will they deliver? On a far more personal level, this is my special love letter to my country. I want the world to fall in love with India. To go back to a Bollywood song again, Ye mera prem patra padhkar ki tum naraaz na ho na. This is a story about India. My India. It is a very personal story. You see, I am exactly as old as India. So in a wonderful way, I am very much a part of the India story. I have watched the country change. Have been a vital part of that change myself. As they say in business circles, I am fully invested in India. Always have been. I have never considered living anywhere else. Never sought opportunities overseas, never fled despite the odds. I kept the faith. And yes, my faith has paid off. I was an early believer. India has that effect on people. For India is very easy to fall in love with. Impossible and demanding, exasperating and annoying, but equally enchanting and alluring, captivating and quixotic. It is difficult for me to be dispassionate about India. I embraced it a long time ago, the way I embraced my own mother, What makes India such a superstar in my eyes? Don't most children think that about their mothers? Today, I, my biological mother, is no more. But I can still claim, Mere paas maa hai, I have India, I feel blessed. Shobhaa Day, March 2008. Right between the eyes. Xmas, Agra, cold and foggy. My husband and I had driven to the city that exists for one reason alone, the Taj Mahal. Like Cairo and the pyramids, Agra and the Taj, they go hand in hand. Just like the freshly scrubbed, neatly dressed school children we saw, making their way to school, skipping along happily on an unpaved, dusty road right outside the city limits of this historic town. Our guide, Mr. Dubey, started on his spiel as my eyes followed the kids. They'd gotten off the road now and were running across a mustard field. It was a scene straight out of a Yash Chopra film. Every imaginable prop was in place. A village woman in a ghungat was drawing water from a well. A shepherd was tending to his flock of well-fed sheep, using a neem twig to get the strays back in line. Sand merchants were unloading sacks at the local mandi, as mica flakes caught the light and twinkled happily. Donkey carts laden with food grain took the same narrow road as hired vehicles of tourists doing Agra in a day. Tourists, like ourselves. Yes, us. Tourists in our own country. The other India. The one we know so little about. And like any outsiders, my husband and I commented on the backwardness of the countryside and wondered what sort of an India those school kids would experience. Would they be excluded from the euphoria? Would they even get to finish their schooling and dream a bigger dream than their parents dared to? Worse, were they already reconciled to their current reality? Did they even know that while empowered, urban India was rejoicing wildly and talking recklessly about being a superpower? Here, in the only city of the world boasting, not one, but three significant heritage sites.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.